The following is a presentation of TFNN. The Power Trading Hour with your host, David White. Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044. Now, David White.
And welcome all to another exciting edition of the Power Trading Hour with me, your humble, lovable, and squeezably soft host. As always, we like to come to you at this time.
The following takes place between 2 p.m. and 3 p.m.
So we've got a nice day here, a little patriotic pop in the market on 9/11. 29.92.71 dollar index coming in and up 34 cents at 98.64. Let's go out here and take a quick look at some of the. Come on. There you go. Futures and commodities. We got crude off $1.36. Gold's up about $4. We got silver off maybe 2 cents. Platinum up $4.90. Copper down a little more than one and a half cents at $2.61. Most people suspect that about $3 in copper is where we actually see the market really start moving. That's kind of the magic tipping point, or it has been in the past, for really fast markets in copper. But nothing really happening right now. Of course, there's two things going on today. One, the remembrances of 9/11. And I miss Andy Heck not being here and talking about his experience that we got to hear of every 9/11. And of course, my favorite thing to do on 9/11 is to watch the movie Man on Wire when the Twin Towers were just going up. It's the top three documentaries I've ever seen. Amazing storytelling. They made it into a very forgettable movie. But the documentary, in retrospect, very, very telling if you've got it on any of your systems. I think it's on most of them. Might be really interesting to see. Stop by a little celebration that they had here in my town for the firemen at lunch. And it's just always good to remember. And back to the markets, which are already in progress over most of TFNN. The S&P, as we said, up 13.5 points. Dow's up 140. The Nasdaq's up 63. The Russell's up 23. So we get to a lot of what's going on. Well, it's Delta neutral day. I don't like to make a lot of decisions for two reasons. One, it's 9/11. Two, it's Delta neutral day. We're going to know a great deal more about the close today than we're going to know that happened during the day. We're going to talk about some fallacies and why we can talk a lot of ways to trade. A bigger issue, I think, is stinking thinking, and that is errors in our logic as we go into it. But just one that kind of came up in one of the emails from one of my subscribers. So we'll talk about that today. We'll look and go into a lot of the other charts that we talked about and didn't get to yesterday. This is the time where I'm going to make money on the next big move in the markets. After we closed out our positions yesterday for an ungodly amount of profit, the time now isn't just to wildly trade and give that money back, but wait and act like more a sniper. Not out with a shotgun, just willy-nilly shooting at things. I tend to wait for the big swing when there are a lot of runners on base, and you can make a lot of wood swinging the bat on the big side. And, you know, if you strike out, you lose a little. But you may have to make a godly amount. Now, we had some very good trades off the bottom. We bought Micron sold it. It may go higher, but we were looking at a market that really looked like it had exhausted itself for the most part on the way up. Maybe there's a little bit more. But the thing that always bothers me in a short-term trade is hanging on to it and trying to make it a longer-term trade. We were looking at a target of 48, got to 49 and some change, and we got out. So it's not much higher than it was when we sold it. But it just depends on what your trade was to begin with. Generally, you want to follow your trade plan. You can always buy it back. But my guess is that we're probably going to consolidate for a while before it goes up. Of course, if you have an entry, I think we bought, or I bought mine in the low 41s for Micron. That gives you a lot of staying power in the market that you may not have rebuying it. But at the same time, I get a lot from being able to leave and go out for an afternoon and not have a ton of positions on that I'll have to explain later. And a little bit of rest. I know everybody else has been on vacation or is on vacation, sometimes you just need that little cracker when you're doing the wine testing to refresh your taste buds and get ready to taste what's coming next. And generally, I like to be on Delta Neutral Day for options expiration as light as I can. Because if you're not in a position, it's very easy to see one when you're in a position, especially one that makes you a lot of money. Man, it's almost impossible to say, hey, I'm going to sell this and see the signals. First of all, highs are tougher than anything to get a good signal on. Lows are relatively, I'm going to say that word in quotes, relatively easier to buy. And I'm extremely good at buying lows. The problem is when you go after that last one at 20%, it's always the day you wake up and you get 50% of your big winnings back. And I would just rather close the door and move on. And if I get yet another signal on Micron or if I get another signal on any of the things we made big money on, I'll go back to them. But generally, after you make a lot of money on something, it goes sideways or maybe even does a retracement of the move that you just got, and maybe even a couple of weeks before it's tradable again. The idea of just sitting there and beating the same drum all day, kind of an anathema for making the bigger moves in a market. It's all about waiting and acting, and of course, the patience is the hardest part. And what else? Okay. What else do we have? I just wanted to look real quick. We've got 4.7 billion shares, which is we're getting back into that fall volume again, which is fairly good. Doesn't get us to about the 10 billion that we really need to go break out the highs. Now, that may come. I'm relatively bullish, but I'm not interested in playing for the next 10 or 15 points in the S&P. So I'm going to wait for the next big signal. I'm going to wait for the next big wave to come or go out. In the meantime, I'm going to have a small break. And then we'll be back. We'll do a little history. And then we'll move on.
If you're not currently using the TAS Profile Scanner when looking at setting up your trading opportunities, then your arsenal is short a mighty weapon. The TAS Profile Scanner is a standalone piece of software that instantly filters over 2,500 global financial markets such as stocks, ETFs, commodity futures, and Forex. Headed by Steve Dahl, TAS understands that in today's technological world, the use of top-flight software applications and technical analysis expertise is essential to successful trading in today's market. You also gain access to the webinar that Steve Dahl and Tom O'Brien just hosted, The Best Way to Use the TAS Profile Scanner to Profit. This webinar archive is available for all subscribers immediately upon signing up. All new subscriptions also come with a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you have nothing to risk. Start your subscription by visiting the front page of TFNN.com today, and you'll find the TAS Profile Scanner under the Services tab. Sign up today. Are you in the market for buying or selling real estate in the Bay Area, including the surrounding St. Petersburg, Tampa, and Clearwater markets? Tiger Real Estate LLC is a firm that has extensive experience in the Tampa Bay Area. Whether you're looking to sell your current property for maximum value, or you're in the market for a second home or investment property, Tiger Realty has the experience across all areas of real estate in the Tampa Bay Area to help buyers and sellers make the most informed decisions across all price levels. From the price you should be paying per square foot in certain up-and-coming areas to the type of cash flow investment properties are capable of creating, Tiger Real Estate can help you make the best decision when it comes to all areas of the market. Before you make one of the biggest decisions of your financial future, call Tiger Real Estate LLC today at 727-329-8322 or email us at tiger@tfnn.com. That's 727-329-8322. Call us today.
Many of our new listeners have heard about The Tiger's Den. The Tiger's Den is a lively community where professional traders and investors can meet, exchange ideas and information in a comfortable, moderated atmosphere. Hear all of the TFNN shows, plus see all of the charts as they happen live and have access to archives of all of those charts. You can test drive The Tiger's Den absolutely free for 30 days and greatly enrich your knowledge of these markets and how to make your money work for you. Details on The Tiger's Den are on the front page of TFNN.com.
TFNN has launched our brand new website. You can still visit us at the same TFNN.com URL, but when you do, you'll see a new and improved homepage with a much simpler navigation, whether you're watching Tiger TV live in high definition or just accessing your newsletter subscriptions. We even have new pricing in 6 months and yearly options. Check out the new TFNN.com now and experience all the upgrades. TFNN.com, educating investors.
Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-873-7618.
And it's all just a little bit of history repeating.
Yeah, we'll ignore the elephant in the room on 9/11. But on this day in 1945, operators of the Harvard Mark II find a moth trapped in relay number 7, panel F. The bug is taped to their troubleshooting log where it was written, first actual case of a bug being found. It's not the first use of the term bug for computer problems, but it was the time that the term debug was used, first time. And of course, when they used if you're across the pond, prisoner of Mother England, they call them valves. In the United States, they call them tubes. Of course, they were the old vacuum tube, which I don't imagine kids probably even know that what a vacuum tube is now. I mean, if they don't know what an 8-track and a cassette is, probably don't know what a tube is. They probably look at it like it was dropped by some alien technology years ahead of us. But they were all tubes back in the time, and there were so many of them and so hot that they put fans at one end and blew air from one end of a giant room to the other with all these tubes or valves in it. And, of course, they were all hot as get out. And, of course, having to have airflow through there, moths and bugs would get into the room. They'd fly around and actually short out some of the tubes. They had young girls that they would hire on roller skates that would roll up and down the aisles of thousands and thousands of these tubes and replace them. They had nice little oven mitts on. They'd pull the tube out that was shorted out and put it back on. But the moths would fly in there and actually put their wings up against some of the contacts. And it was like 500 or 600 volts on some of those tubes and would short them out and cause a problem in the computer's data coming through. And that's why they are called bugs on this day in 1945. Now, there's some other things I wanted to talk about. Got some emails. But I wanted to talk about something called the prosecutor's fallacy, a error in your logic and the way statistics fall. One of the problems, and I try to shy away from getting into the weeds with statistics, but this one's kind of an interesting one to know. And that is that why statistics don't lie, liars can quote statistics. And most people aren't familiar enough with them that it's not problematic. There have been some giant errors and people go to jail for statistics, some fairly big cases. One of them was that someone said that there was only a, I think it was one chance, I forget what it was. I think it was like one chance in 100,000 that this person could have done this by some kind of DNA evidence. It was kind of early in on it. The problem was that the one in 100,000 was kind of interesting, but it was also in a city of 6 million. When you come to find out, there were 50 people, 49 or 50 people, that also could have done it. And of course, the error in the logic now is that the guy isn't one in a one in five or one in 100,000 or one in a million. He's one out of 49. So the chance that he did it is pretty minor, actually, if you look at it the correct way. But most people will look at it, there's once, you know. Now, if the person knows them, you know, was dating them, had opportunity, nothing else, that would be a huge change in it. But the idea that when people quote statistics, the problem is they do it fairly badly, don't give you all the background, and it can be incredibly misleading. We saw an election last night that I thought was extremely interesting because the polls had the guy that won down 12 points, and he won by two or three. The question is, did the press deliberately say something wrong, or did they just misquote or purposely avoid the real statistics that mostly had this guy winning all along? You can be steered wrong this way a great deal. And of course, there's two very famous cases of the prosecutor's fallacy of looking at things two ways. Dwayne Jackson served 8 years for a crime he did not commit. Unfortunately, he was a criminal. he did before this serve or do a lot of horrible things. So it wasn't undeserved that somebody pointed him out and somebody else. But when they did the DNA, they said there was one in 100,000 chance, he was one in 100,000 that he did it. So pretty high odds. The problem was that this is kind of early on in the late 90s, that there was somebody that was a much better match. And of course, he did a crime about 6 years later. And guess what? He was a perfect match. He wasn't just close, he was perfect. And of course, he was a cousin of Dwayne Jackson. And you really have to look very deep in it. It took another 2 years to get him out of jail after everybody didn't want to talk about how they made a big mistake. But if you ever go to court, if they start quoting any kind of statistics, just be very, very careful. This is used on both sides. And of course, used very famously in the OJ case, where they also pointed out that although he may be a close match, that also means there were another 6,000 people in town that could do it. But again, then you have to start putting the case back together. The reason I kind of bring this up is you don't want to really depend on one single thing. You want to make sure that correlation just is not causation, that people start drowning in the summer and ice cream goes up. Doesn't mean ice cream sales go up. Doesn't mean that ice cream caused those people to drown. It got warmer. More people went swimming. More people ate ice cream. And of course, probably more important in the election was confirmation bias. We have a lot of people that have kind of a pretty finite worldview in the world, and those are the people that give us our news. A lot of people, it's very tough. Now, that's in the press. We have something that's even a little nicer, and that is price. It is the final arbiter of telling us whether we are right or wrong on the trade. But we don't need to know if we're right or wrong on the morals of the company, just whether or not in our business, whether we're right on the price direction. We're going to go to break here. We're going to go to a lot of charts. We're going to try to do that again today. As I said, I'm looking at this as a good time. Sit back and really see what the market's doing and telling us. Of course, we go into the Fed next week. The question is whether or not we just bounce around in this area a few more days. We'll be back in a minute.
Path of Least Resistance is David White's daily trading newsletter, and if you're looking for active trading ideas, then now's a perfect time for a 30-day free trial to this powerful daily trading advisory service. David uses his years of trading experience to offer his subscribers his trading ideas each morning in his Path of Least Resistance newsletter. Using a combination of equity trades along with options, David keeps his subscribers up to date with all pertinent market information with intraday afternoon updates when warranted. Don't miss out on this great chance to get a 30-day free trial to David's daily newsletter, The Path of Least Resistance, with no obligation to pay anything. David has been delivering solid recommendations for his subscribers recently, and if you'd like to see the type of newsletter he delivers every morning, then visit the front page of TFNN, and you'll find The Path of Least Resistance under Trading Newsletters. For all the details and to start your 30-day free trial today, log on to TFNN.com now.
Hi folks, Tom O'Brien here. If you'd like to get my daily newsletter, Market Insights, then now is a great time to sign up for a 30-day free trial. Every morning by 9:30, I send out my morning letter to subscribers with market commentary on a variety of markets, currencies, and commodities to keep investors up to date on the day's trading action. Included in Market Insights are specific buy and sell recommendations for stocks, ETFs, and even options, with stops and price targets included for every trade in my newsletter. If you'd like to try my newsletter risk-free for 30 days, then head over to the front page of TFNN and you'll find Market Insights under Trading Newsletters. I use my years of trading experience to bisect and dissect the market every morning and give my subscribers the most important information they need to know for the day ahead. I even issue afternoon updates for my subscribers whenever warranted with important market action. I'm always scouring the market for the next great trading opportunity. Sign up for your 30-day free trial to my daily newsletter, Market Insights, today by visiting the front page of TFNN.com. Wow! Go get them, folks.
TFNN is excited about our new software charting program, The Art of Timing the Trade Charts. In collaboration with Tom O'Brien and using his best-selling book, The Art of Timing the Trade, Your Ultimate Trading Mastery System, David White has programmed an outstanding piece of software that will complement any trader's methodology. Using this first-of-its-kind program, The Art of Timing the Trade Charts allows you to scan thousands of stocks for Fibonacci formation setups, including Gartley's, ABC's, Butterflies, and much more. The Art of Timing the Trade Charts is designed to help you when scouring the markets for stocks just beginning to form the trading patterns that many investors spend days, weeks, or even months searching to find. And right now, we're offering licenses available at only $79 a month. We are so confident that you're going to love this new charting software that will even give you a 30-day unconditional money-back guarantee. Don't miss out on this incredible new piece of software. Get your copy of The Art of Timing the Trade Charts today by visiting TFNN.com.
This segment is brought to you by Think or Swim. For more information, just click the Think or Swim banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
And we're back. We're going to go through as many charts as we can. You can always give me a call at 877-927-6648. I want to look at Zoomies. It broke out with volume a few days ago above the $30 range on the 6th on 3.4 million shares. The next day you had 1.5 million shares yesterday. Today you get about 458,000. If you want to buy on the pullback, this is a valid breakout. And actually, I think it's fairly extensive, if I'm not mistaken. Let's go back and look a little longer time frame. This goes back to trying to break these highs back to June 8th of 2018. So you had about a year of consolidation. You're right at those levels. If you can break and get through the about $32 to $32.70, you're very close on it. Now we're right at that level, so we haven't broken through it just yet. But you got above it with some decent volume, not as high as the volume back on June 8th that had 4.4 million shares, 31.55. But if it holds above here, you've tried three times. Sometimes these things just chew through. But probably a fairly decent risk reward going forward if the market after the Fed comes through looks like it's a little bit better. Weyerhaeuser, of course, a lot of people saying that the end of housing, these stocks have looked fairly horrible in the housing market, but they're still going higher. April 5th, $27.17 in the manufacturer? Yeah, supplier. $27.17 with 5 million shares on April 5th. You're going through that today with 2.1 million shares. So you are kind of hitting the high end of this range on that one. Wolverine Worldwide just kind of bouncing back in to its area. Werner Enterprises, another one that's in the supplier to business construction. Actually kind of breaking out of its levels. Not a lot of juice today, though. Again, that's why I suspect we're probably in some kind of narrowing trading range, looking at the 3,000 mark on the S&P cash. So maybe we'll get that in the next couple of days. I just don't see some kind of big move like with the one we've had off the bottom. And I'm always reticent if I don't have my back to the wall and either everybody's buying or everybody's selling. Vector Group Limited, VGR is a symbol on this one, going through a 3 million share November 13th high. 3.3 million shares at $12.87, going through that today with a 1.4 million shares so far. So that's going to break through an important level with half of the volume. USNA, going back and filling its gap down from, what is that, July the 3rd, came down with 2 million shares. You're back into it with a little over 100,000 shares, filling that gap today, so keep an eye on that one. Urban Outfitters, it's coming back to this big gap down that it had with a volume that's 10 million shares on the downside. I don't know what earnings are, but this may be, I don't like short stocks under $30, but, and I certainly wouldn't hold it through earnings, but this does look like a fairly decent setup for lower prices. That gap came down on May 22nd with 10 million shares. Today you're up into that gap with 2.5 million shares. This may not even get to 30% of the volume of this gap down a few months ago. And sales in malls are not getting any better. They're getting worse. Take a look and see what else we had. The 30-year TMF is coming back to what is fairly decent support. This is the gap up on August 12th with 1.1 million shares. Got into it yesterday with 2.2 million shares. This 1.3, you can get a little bounce out of this, maybe 31.5, and maybe it'll start an ABC on the way back down to fill the rest of those gaps. Cisco, now this isn't the router company that is in the internet. This is the one that runs around delivering food to all the chain restaurants. Darn near a monopoly, actually. I always wonder when they're going to get busted up. It has broken through the May 22nd high. That was 75.34 with 2.5 million shares. You got into it and broke through it with volume with 3.7 million shares. That was on the 9th, yesterday or the day before yesterday, 3.2 million shares. Is that right? Today, 1.8 million shares. So, again, starting to run out of a little gas, but we've got some valid breaks of highs with decent volume in a lot of these stocks. Some not so much, but there are a few out here that look fairly strong. Again, you can give me a call at 877-927-6648 or email me at path@tfnn.com. On the downside, SVXY has come and filled this gap. So we know you want to look at UVXY, the sister, and see what it's doing. Of course, the decay is much faster on this one than any other. I, again, think that we're going to probably have narrowing volatility through the Fed, which is next week from tomorrow, for their announcement. And we will be looking at it. But I think it's not beyond the scope of reason to see that the UVXY would be back down into the 23 level. Most of the action is probably going to come after the Fed next week. Let's see, what else do we have? SSRM. Let's do a quick profile on those. Okay. SSR mining has hit a low, but it's about the same volume as before. No good signal out of here other than it's down with about 1 million shares, but really you need less than 1.3. That is not a good sign for that one. I'll take a quick look at the SOX semiconductors. And this is the bear side of it. Breaking below the previous July 24th low that had 4 million shares. You got about 1.4 million shares today. And again, you're probably getting into pretty severe resistance in most all of these sectors. Smith Micro, seeing a huge gap up on the 26th of July, did so with 22 million shares. You're back into this thing just with 1 million shares now. You know, $4.50, $4.75. I would watch that one very closely, because this one does have a nice, very setup. SGMO is kind of one of the genetic editing companies that does it old school. They're not like the newer versions of these stocks. And this thing's been making a triangle for a very long time. Keep a close eye on this after it breaks out. But I'm putting this on my radar. Generally, you want to fade the first breakout on these, but this is, looks fairly interesting. Wouldn't short a $13 stock, so I'm hoping that it pulls back a bit, and that is a chance to get into that one. We'll be back in a minute. We've got a lot of more stocks to look at. Give me a call, 877-927-6648.
If you're in the CD market and looking for a secure investment, the Tiger First Mortgage Program may work for you. The security for these first mortgages are building lots in the tax opportunity zone in St. Petersburg, Florida. The Tax Act of 2018 set up tax-free zones across the country where you can build and hold for 10 years and pay no tax on the profits, which makes these lots valuable. The investment is anywhere from $30,000 to $75,000. The interest paid is 7% yearly, paid on a monthly basis. According to Bankrate.com, the best rate for a four-year CD in the country as of February 20th is 3.1%. A $50,000 investment at a normal four-year CD rate of 3.1% would give you income of $1,550 per year or $6,200 over the four-year period. That same $50,000 investment in the Tiger First Mortgage Program would give you $3,500 per year or $14,000 over the 4 years. Which would you prefer, $6,200 or $14,000 of interest on your investment? If you would like more information about the Tiger First Mortgage Program, you can call me at 877-518-9190. That's 877-518-9190.
If you haven't checked out the newsletters page of TFNN.com, what are you waiting for? All of the TFNN newsletters are informative, up-to-date, affordable, and must-have for every trader looking to gain a competitive informational edge in today's markets. TFNN newsletters cover every aspect of the markets to offer you the very latest in market news. Plus, new subscribers get to test drive our newsletters risk-free for 30 days. From all aspects of the markets, including stocks, bonds, metals, commodities, and tech, there's a newsletter to fit your needs exclusively from TFNN. Stay informed each day you trade and get the competitive edge that will help you stay ahead of the game. Visit our newsletters page by going to TFNN.com and click the newsletters button near the top of the page. TFNN.com. educating investors.
Are China A-shares hot or not? If you trade China A-shares, now may be time to take a closer look. Trade CHAU or CHAD, Direction's daily CSI 300 China A-share bull and bear ETFs. China A-shares in either direction. Visit directioninvestments.com today. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the Direction shares carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction shares. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact Direction shares at 866-476-7523. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors such as traders and active investors. Distributor Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
Don't forget, you can listen to TFNN live on your mobile device 24 hours per day. Go to TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV. That's TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV for the latest market information.
I had a question via email about Netflix. Do I think it's that big of a deal? The answer is I think so, because a lot of other people could do the exact same thing, which is offer a low price for the first year and siphon off a lot of Netflix customers in this space. Of course, Apple, as I said before, you never want to really short Apple around these things. They have a very cadre of sympathetic, and I'll say sycophantic, tech reporting on the stock. What you do have is a 70 million share high today being charged today with 33 million shares so far. So you're not going to get up here and get any kind of volume you got as you broke through to the high end that reversed on July 31st. So actually kind of a weaker signal on this. You do have an all-time high at that 229.90 from October 3rd, 2018. It's probably going to test that. You got a little less volume there, but you really have to worry about this July 31st thing. But again, it's all about perception, and the perception is that the sycophantic tech press will slobber all over themselves to get Apple. And everything else is kind of cold fish, sushi. Is it really as bright as they said it is? But this is not the kind of company like a GoPro or Roku or the rest that literally are just going to fall apart and be nothing in several years, at least in my opinion. They've got a product that people buy. It's very expensive. They make lots of money off of it. It's not going to zero. Maybe it gets a pullback if they can't execute going forward. But for the most part, this thing's going to be a slow slog. It's not going to be get broke and done. But today, unless they get a lot more volume before the end of the day, is going to be fairly good indication that that 229.90 is probably about as good as you're going to get for a while on Apple. If you're long this thing, if volume does not come in, I suspect that's what you want to do. Now, it may be a little bit more quietly that they're expecting a very good next year with the advent of new 5G phones, which they didn't talk about yesterday. But there's still a lot of discussion about whether or not they're going to have some in December or January. That whole 5G upgrade cycle is probably a good reason to get a new iPhone. Besides all the other features that it has, mostly it's just a lot of camera, new camera lenses. I think they got three Ford-looking cameras on the thing, including a really kind of what they call a fisheye, a wide-angle lens on it, which is interesting, but not that exciting. Okay. And somebody says they missed something in the... Yeah, truth is, you miss a million things. After 20 years, I can remember all the things I've missed. But I don't let them weigh on me too much, because a lot of these things are not visible going forward. There was no signal in the charts. There was no news. All you saw was stock moving up. And then, of course, that's it. Now, did it move up on volume? Maybe, maybe not. But the idea that we're omnipotent, seer of all, was a little bit too much. About 20% of the moves in various stocks are, you know, really get telegraphed in the charts. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for the stuff we can see, not the stuff that we can't see. SeaWorld Entertainment, Mr. Blackfish, gapped up on the 28th of May, did so on 7.3 million shares, got back in and filled that gap with maybe 2 million, at a, 2.5 million at a high. It's now kind of popped off, probably in a trading range now between this $27 and $34 range. RTRX, now that thing's just going to in a handbasket. Raytheon, the big supplier to industry and the military, a nice 6 million share high on June 10th at 192.94. As I said, 6 million shares on that date. Yesterday, as we went up to it, 2 million shares. Today, just 800,000 shares. So, again, I'm not expecting a lot out of these things as they start challenging highs on fairly light volume. We got a few minutes left to go. Regeneron, and still hasn't popped back into the trading range. Pretium Resources. And I don't see anything in that one. PSX. Phillips 66. As far as the big oil conglomerates, a lot of them have come back and filled these gaps that they've had back in 2018. In this case, Phillips 66 down on a fairly heavy volume of about 4 million shares back on the 19th of October, 2018. And of course, you came up here and tried to get into it back in late July. Didn't have much volume. Got a little better volume now, 2.4 million shares yesterday. But today, you went right into that with a million shares, filled about half of that remaining gap. And I'd say that's probably all you can look at getting for Phillips 66. I think it's pretty richly priced at this point. Party City, it's come off the bottom, but still doesn't look that good. PolyOne Corporation, another one that looks like it's just finished filling its gap. This gap came down on the 24th of October, 2018, up or down on 1.5 million, well, almost 1.6 million shares, filling today with just a little over 500,000 shares so far. So that may be in a bigger trading range from about $35 down to 24. There is a nice big fat double gap at 28. That would probably be my first target on that. What else do we have? Sacra Blue. Pitney Bowes, still not a lot of reasons to have a stamp machine these days, going the way of the dodo, but you know what? Doesn't mean it can't go lower. August 6, this got to $4.52 with 8.5 million shares, back into it today with 2.2 million shares. So the buggy whip manufacturers are still around. Oil States International testing its previous high of July 31st, $15.71, that had almost a million shares. Got into it yesterday with 525,000 shares. Today, just 330,000 shares as we kind of push on the highs there. NXPI, a little bit of the phone business rubbing off from Apple on it today, but not the volume. 10.6 million shares on May 3rd, 108.22. And what do you got today? You got 3.4. Is that right? No, 2.2 million shares today, 3.4 million shares yesterday. That looks very interesting. If we get the socks looking weak in the next week or so, I'll keep an eye on some of these. Let's look at the SMHs when we get back. Give me a call, 877-927-6648.
I'm certain you are or strive to be one of the best of the best at everything you do in life. It's the most common trait that we tigers and tigresses share. If you're looking to become the best of the best when it comes to managing your money, let me teach you to do what most wealth managers tell you can't be done, which is how to time the markets. I'm Steve Rhodes, author of Mastering Probability, and for the last 12 months, Timer Digest has been tracking my newsletter signals, which have earned me the ranking as their number one market timer in the nation for the S&P 500 for the last 12, 6, and 3 months. Timer Digest also ranks me as the number one market timer for gold as well. The fact is, markets can be timed, and I'll teach you the exact set of tools that I use that has transformed me into one of the best at what I do. Sign up for Mastering Probability today by clicking on the newsletter tab on the homepage of TFNN.com and get immediate access to workshops where I take you step by step how to use an extraordinary set of tools as well as provide great market calls too. Sign up today.
David White's newsletter, The Technology Insider, is focused like a laser on finding the next big things in technology. If you had invested only $10,000 in Microsoft in 1986, you'd have been a millionaire by 2000. Disruptive technology like Microsoft's is the key to these massive long-term profits, and The Tech Insider is the vehicle from TFNN to capitalize on these opportunities. This is the go-to newsletter that identifies, monitors, and profits on mostly little-known cutting-edge companies with great long-term prospects. David's experience is as an inventor of Emmy-winning animation products for TV and Hollywood that propelled a company public. Match that with 14 years as a full-time trader, and he's uniquely qualified to guide you through the light-speed world of ever-evolving high-tech. If you're ready to ride the next big technology bull market for less than $40 per month, log on to TFNN.com and get your two-week free trial to The Technology Insider. Get in on the ground floor of the next big thing today. Since 1984, Basil Chapman has been using the Chapman Wave methodology to advise traders of his expert market opinion. While originally hand-drawing charts from the late 1970s into the 1980s, Basil noticed that prices under most circumstances virtually always had a certain number of legs to the upside before declining sharply. Later, Basil found that computer software, which included the standard market technical indicators, enhanced the degree of accuracy in calling price turns as well as market trend calls. Thus was born the Chapman Wave sequence. Using the Chapman Wave methodology along with other indicators, Basil Chapman advises his subscribers of his expert market opinion each market day with his opening call newsletter. Right now, you can get a two-week free trial to the opening call, Basil's daily trading newsletter, by visiting the front page of TFNN.com. Cancel at any time during that trial and pay absolutely nothing. Get your two-week free trial to Basil's newsletter, the opening call, today by visiting TFNN.com.
Catch Tom O'Brien, professional trader and educator, founder of TFNN, also a special guest on CNBC. Tom will bisect and dissect the markets. The Tom O'Brien Show, next on TFNN.
And we're back. First question is Walgreens Boots Alliance. And this gap down on the 2nd of April did so with 37 million shares. Back up into it today with a little less than 4 million shares. Yesterday got into it with 7 million shares. To me, the layup on this one would be shorting it at $59. You had two tests of the low. Both of them were about 6 million shares. That didn't really see a great deal of testing that one with lighter volume. You know, there are better shorts out here probably, but I mean, this is the pattern I look at for short, not going long. If I bought this at the lows, I'd try to be at it about $59. At best, it's going to go sideways as everybody above it decides to maybe even take a thin little loss on this going back into it. But not looking that good. Question about why are the new Apple devices not 5G? And they just haven't had a chance to put the Qualcomm chips in them yet. I think that's mostly it. The Apple takes about 9 months to get a product once everything is designed and out the door. And I have a feeling that probably Qualcomm just wasn't, I mean, they were still arguing back then. So they'll be a little bit late to the party. You can already, of course, order the Samsungs with the Qualcomm 5G chip in them already. My guess is that it's a big first quarter thing for next year for them. They are working on it. We've heard those more than rumors on it. In the meantime, it'll be a late night for me going through all the options charts. We'll be talking about that tomorrow. So I gotta have to get a little sleep in somewhere. So when you can, not when you have to. We'll be back here tomorrow, same bat channel, same bat time.